Ladies and gentlemen, a little over a year ago, when my colleagues and I sat down to discuss the possibility of holding a convention around the theme of game changers, we did so with our next speaker in mind. Now, the IoD showed a real interest in Uber from quite early days, not just because it represented a quicker and easier and very often cheaper way to get around London, but more interestingly, because of what it represented and what it showed us about the future of our economy and the future marketplace. Because this is a service and an idea which really embodied what we mean when we talk about disruption. True disruption of an existing market and a proliferation of choice for the consumer. But of course, I think most interestingly of all, what Uber and other apps and services within what's being called the sharing economy or the new economy, although I quite like to think of it just as the economy, what these apps and these services show is that if you break down the barriers to entry in the economy, you can really lift in people who are otherwise not being economically active. With a car and an app, or a website and a spare room, you can enter the economy. And I think that's incredibly exciting. Now, Uber has had an extraordinary story. From 5 years ago, as the preserve of some wealthy techies in San Francisco, it is now one of the fastest growing companies in the world, recently valued at just under $18 billion, operating now in over 100 cities in 45 countries. Let's take a moment to see how they did that.
Uber's mission is to go to every major city in the world and roll out an efficient, convenient, elegant transportation system. I like to think that Uber is creating a new way of getting around cities. First use case that matters in a city is going out. You know, maybe it's date night or maybe it's going out to the clubs with friends. But very quickly, it starts to move into daytime use. You get used to pushing that button at night on Friday or Saturday. Then you're stuck between meetings and you need to get somewhere. And it sort of works its way from the weekend into the weekday. That simplicity around not having to think about how I'm going to get from point A to point B is huge. In cities around the world, especially the major ones, you have a very stagnant transportation ecosystem. A lot of times they don't work. Bringing innovation to this world, which in many cases really hasn't been innovated on in decades, can really bring diversity to a system that hasn't seen a lot of that. Uber is everyone's private driver, and the drivers are the lifeblood of Uber. We're bringing that kind of experience to the masses.
I started with one car, and right now I have several cars. I couldn't see myself managing 5, 6, 7 drivers without Uber. I would have to have a whole office, dispatcher, and now it's easy.
I set my hours around my kids' school. Once I take care of them, then I can schedule any day, anytime I want to work. The freedom is the big component of my decision to join Uber.
So much about cities is how you get around them. If you can bring real efficiency, real convenience, and real comfort to how you move around that city, you can change the way people live in that city.
Well, let's meet the man who made it all happen. Would you please welcome to the stage Travis Kalanick.
All right, well, that video makes it easy. I think I only need to speak for a minute or two after that. It's really good to be in London. We've just seen incredible growth over a very short period of time, and it's really fun to see. You know, I open up my app when I come into the city, and I can get a ride in just a few minutes. It's been a pretty remarkable ride. So to give you a little background on where we come from, when I go to Paris, I like to say that we were founded in Paris. It was really that Paris was the inspiration. This is a romantic shot of me and my co-founder in front of the Eiffel Tower. We couldn't get a taxi. I'm not sure if you guys have experienced taxis in Paris, but it can be difficult. And my co-founder was like, you know, I'd just like to push a button and get a ride. And so we just decided to make that. And so it was really simple. Well, at least once you build all the technology, is the consumer gets an app in the App Store, they open it up, they can see the cars that are close to them. They push a button, they see the car coming to them, and when it arrives, they're notified. They get in the car, because they already are a user, their credit card is on file, and when they get to the destination, they just walk out of the car. At the end of the trip, you see how much you paid, and you can also rate the driver on 5 stars. Of course, that's how we keep the service levels high, and both sides actually get rated, which keeps both sides accountable. And we have this internal tool that we call God View. And operationally, we need to make sure we see all the trips that are happening at any given time. This is super early in San Francisco. I remember this is a Friday night, and 4 trips were happening at once. And a couple of us were running around the office like super pumped, like, oh my God, there's 4 trips going. This is amazing. And those are the early days, but it always starts small. Right, so Uber has an operations team and an office in every city that we're in. And you know, this starts working for a few people, and they tell their friends, and their friends tell theirs. This is London yesterday. Just a quick zoom in on what's going on. And to make this work for hundreds of thousands or millions of people in a city means you have a lot of cars on the road. When you have a lot of cars on the road that are doing potentially dozens of trips a day, you're actually taking a whole bunch of cars off the road. In fact, in our current model here in London, there's 7.5 cars taken off the road for every fully utilized Uber that's on the road. And of course, choice is part of that, right? When we first started in London, we had a very high-end service. We call it Uber Lux. Little more than a black cab, probably 20 or 30% more. Usually an S-Class Extended for the car geeks in the house. But we also have other choices, right? We have black cabs, of course, on the system. And we also, of course, have UberX, which is our low-cost alternative, which is about half the price of a black cab. This is what happens when you get to hyperscale. So this is New York. As you can see, there are cars everywhere. But those cars get utilized. And so in times when it's raining, you might get a huge influx in demand. What will happen is during some extreme cases or rare circumstances, weather or otherwise events, the price will come up for a short period of time so that more cars come on the system so that everybody gets a ride. And so reliability is number one for us. Flexible supply and flexible price allows that to happen. But you still have only single-digit percentage of times that price does go up or down. But when you get to that scale, you start to see the average pickup times go way down. And it's not just in San Francisco, New York, or London. It's in cities around the world. We're actually in 200 cities in 45 countries. Places in Latin America, Europe, Africa, and Asia. But how do you make sure that no matter where you are in the world, there's always an Uber car 5 minutes away from you? There's actually a lot of math and logistics that make that happen. We have a team of scientists from all kinds of different backgrounds. We have computational neuroscientists, nuclear physicists, who take their data models for that kind of science and adapt them to the logistics science, right? So how do we make sure that we're able to make sure that there's a car just 5 minutes away from you? We have to predict what demand is going to be in the next 15 minutes, let's say. And if we know where that demand is, we say, well, where are the cars on the system now? Those cars act, if we have a heat map, we say, where are the cars right now? The cars act as anti-heat. They suck heat out of the map, and what's left is underserved demand. We'll present that underserved demand heat map to the drivers so that drivers can move towards where demand is, so that the curve of supply over multiple dimensions actually matches where demand is going to be and when. And so when you get really good at getting cars right where they're supposed to be, right before somebody pushes that button, you see huge growth. San Francisco is our home city. It's where we started a little over 4 years ago. And it's actually the second lowest line here. You see Los Angeles, New York, and London. This is basically the x-axis being how much time since the city has launched. And you notice that London is one of our fastest growing cities. It's about to pass Los Angeles as the fastest growing city we've seen. Now, San Francisco has existed longer, so if this thing went out further, you'd see that San Francisco is higher than all of these cities. But in the first 2.5 years, London is at parity with Los Angeles in terms of growth. And what does that mean for us, right? That means we have over 500,000 Londoners using Uber with thousands of partners. Partners for us are the drivers that are on the road you saw in the video earlier. Of course, doing millions of trips, but we're a different kind of tech company. We're not a tech company that just has technology that doesn't really engage in the local economy. Remember, every trip is done by an operator who is essentially a small business operating in the city, right? 100% of the fare, 80% goes to that operator. And of course, 100% of that fare is taxed. And so it's easy to show charts that go up and to the right when you're really small. You can multiply by 2 in a week. And in fact, in the last 12 months, we've gotten 27 times bigger here in London. But we're starting to be substantive here in the city because we have, in the last month, we have 7,000 active drivers on the road. Now remember, for each of those cars on the road, you're taking 7.5 cars off of the road, right? Out of parking lots, off the streets, looking for parking often. And ultimately, you're getting more people in these cars. And so just reducing the number of trips, car trips, that are necessary in the city, easing congestion. But what happens when, of course, time goes on and we continue to grow? Now, that growth is inevitably going to slow. So 27x over the 12 months, last 12 months, that's not going to happen again. But we expect over the next 6 months, we're going to 3x. And in the year after that, we're going to 2x. And then you say, wow, that things start to get interesting, because that means in 18 months, you have 42,000 drivers on the road on our system. Large portion of them basically choosing to use Uber because they're making a better living, a better income, feeding their families. And a large portion of them are actually new to the business. You're just literally expanding the number of jobs in a city. So we're talking about tens of thousands of new jobs in one city in a very short period of time. And why is that happening? Why is that kind of growth happening? It's happening because we are able to get that efficiency going where that car is very close to you when you push that button. That means that driver has very little downtime. That means he does more trips per hour. And the more trips he does per hour, the lower the price can get, right? So if you're going from London Bridge to Kensington, of course, if you're using Uber Lux, it's gonna cost you a little bit, but it's gonna be a nice ride. If you use Uber X, you're gonna be in a Prius, but it's gonna cost only £12. And that's when stuff gets really interesting. Because when the cost of the ride goes down, then you start to be so inexpensive, so accessible, that you no longer need to own a car. You basically, and we're seeing in our biggest cities, people are selling their second car. Some people selling their first car, right? So instead of owning a car, there's of course huge costs that go with that. You could just take Uber and actually break even, and you don't have to be frustrated behind the wheel. But there's other things that come with it, right? It makes your city smarter. So in Seattle, we've seen a 10% reduction in DUI, drinking under the influence. That means fewer injuries. That means fewer deaths on the road. In Chicago, there's been a reduction in taxi crime. We do taxis. We have a huge taxi business in Chicago, as well as UberX. 20% reduction in taxi crime in the year after we launched in Chicago. And this is a heat map right here. Looks like one of those Freudian psychology questions, but this is a heat map of demand. And when you get to scale, you start to cover the whole region. And what we see is that 40% of the trips that we're doing here in London are in traditionally underserved areas, areas that aren't served well by transportation infrastructure. And so you make the city accessible from people who are not in those areas, but you make the rest of the city accessible to people who are in those areas. And so what it ultimately means is fewer cars in London, right? Because those are shared assets. Those are vehicles that are being shared amongst dozens of people a day, instead of the person who's in that car and then parks, right? So of course, when you don't have sharing, you have a lot of cars on the road. I think everybody here is familiar with the notorious London traffic. 3 million cars here in London. Every day, 3 million cars on the roads. They're only being utilized 5% of the time. That means the other 95% of the time, they're sitting and parking somewhere. Parking in London takes up 14% of the space in the city. If you can reduce the number of cars on the road, the city starts to open up. Not just the roads, because there's less traffic, but the city just starts to breathe a little easier. So I've sort of told the story of where we've gone, but what about where it could go? What happens when we grow, we continue to grow over the next 18 months as we've outlined? I mean, there's a huge number of new income opportunities or new jobs that are going to be created. And of course, like I said before, taking a huge number of cars off the road. With our current model, again, 7.5 cars off the road for every, I meant 6x. So there are 6 cars taken off the road for every fully utilized Uber that's on the road. But what happens when we start to do new innovative things? We're testing a service right now in San Francisco that we launched 2 months ago called Uber Pool. What happens is it's just like Uber as you know it. You push a button and your Uber comes. But you get in the car and there's somebody else already in there. And the reason we can do that is because we're so liquid, we have so many trips happening, that your route is the same route or along the same line as the other person at the same time. And so you don't have to go more than 2 minutes out of your way, but then the cost goes down by another 50%. And when you start getting into those kinds of economics, you can really move a lot of people out of cars. And you get, for every fully utilized Uber on the road, you literally get 12 cars off of the road. Right? And I like to talk about the perpetual trip, the trip that never ends, right? So the driver picks one passenger up, picks another passenger up, drops off the first passenger, but then picks up passenger number 3, and then drops off passenger number 2. When this is really liquid, that driver will always be carrying somebody. And when that happens, the number of trips or people trips that he can do per hour shoots through the roof and the prices go down even further. And so Uber Pool from London Bridge to Kensington starts to look like 6 pounds. And this is only months away. We're gearing up to launch Uber Pool here in London before the end of the year. And you go, okay, well, what about the ideal world? Like, how far can this go? Let's sort of have a suspension of disbelief and say, what if cars were 100% shared? No Uber pooling, but 100% shared. You would take 2.5 million cars off the road and out of parking lots and get everybody where they wanted to go. Now, it still means most of the time, there's one person in one car going somewhere. You reduce traffic because you don't have people looking for parking, and the drivers, of course, are much more efficient, but you only have so much upside there. When you go into pooling, things really get interesting, because you're taking another 50% of the cars off the road, and you're taking them off the streets. Congestion literally goes down by 50%. Now, this is the sort of idealized version if everybody was carpooling, right? When you make it so that it works, so that you're never 2 minutes out of your way, and you're bringing the prices down substantially, a lot fewer people sort of get smushed up into the Northern Line. And so what about a big idea? Like, if we've got 3 million cars on the road today, what if we could just take 1 million off the road? What would it take? Well, first we've got to launch Uberpool, right? That's something that is happening before the end of the year, like I mentioned. But it also means we need to get 100,000 new drivers on the road. They have to go through the licensing process that exists today. And that's something we're going to be working really hard to do. But it's realistic. It's something we can do. We're already doing in excess of 1,000 per month already. And so you say, well, you know, how can we really start spinning this up? There's processes and operations, of course. There's a controversial topic that has been embraced in the US. They have regulatory frameworks for it. They call it peer-to-peer. But what if anybody could be a driver as long as they got a good background check and insurance covered these rides? Could you unlock a whole bunch of drivers to make this kind of vision happen? It's possible. But London has a very sophisticated transportation regulatory framework. And I think there's some interesting questions for the TfL about how they want to approach this or not. So imagine what that looks like when we get to that future, right? 1 million fewer cars in London with significantly less congestion. I don't even know what it'd be like to walk out there and see no traffic. But that future is actually possible. And what about the emissions, just the carbon footprint efficiencies that come out of this? And of course, the 100,000 more jobs that are created. This is just good for the city. It's good for riders and for drivers. And so we're super excited at Uber about what's about to happen in the fastest growing city that we have of the 200 that we're in. And we're very much looking forward to a congestion-free London. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Travis. I think we have time for just a couple of questions. What I'm particularly interested in is the sort of corporate characteristics that Uber currently demonstrates. It's certainly the case that in the past, I know that your characteristic has been, you've been insurgent, and therefore you've been reasonably scrappy, you might say aggressive. But of course, you're not the underdogs anymore in this field. And I wondered whether you had any regrets over the sort of tone of your arrival into the market, or whether you're just tempering it now that you're a slightly different business to when you first started out taking on all those enemies as you framed them.
I get this question a little bit, and I have no idea where that might have come from. We obviously have a few fights. We have to go out there and fight for what we believe in some cases. But I think the difference is that when you're the small underdog, I think you can be a little more brash than I think when you're the big guy.
And of course, you think that some people would be intimidated by the pace and the scale of the change that you're representing.
That's possible. I think, you know, getting at the question, though, is that I think, you know, my previous company I did for 6.5 years, 4 years of which I didn't make a salary. So I'm really used to being the little guy. And so it's taken, in this company, we're only 4 years old right now. So it's, you know, I'm still getting used to being perceived as the bigger one. And so we just have to be a little more diplomatic and a little more statesmanlike, and I'm working on it.
Sure. And of course, you refer to the scale of your operation now. I mean, how do you keep a handle on a company that is growing at this rate, that you can go into the office on a Monday and by the end of the week you're in new cities, you've got more staff, you've got more drivers on the books? How do you keep in control?
Yeah, I think everybody's management style is different. The way I run my company is really very similar to how I did it when we were just five people. And basically in the morning I wake up and I have two lists. One list is the super interesting, really difficult problems that need to be solved. And I approach them, I'm a computer engineer by training, I approach them as an engineer. It's a fun puzzle to get into and figure out. And it often requires invention of some kind. but creative problem solving. The other list is all the cool things that we want to invent. And so every day, those are the two things I do. I solve problems and invent stuff. And whether we're 1,600 people or so now, or five people, for me, it feels very similar. In a weird kind of way, it actually doesn't feel that much different for me.
And finally, I'm very interested to see the way in which you start to talk about your operations in political terminology. And I know that you've taken on board some political strategists, and you talk about yourself as being the challenger candidate. You talk about the taxi industry as being the incumbent. Why did you start to think of it in those terms? And do you think that's a lesson that more businesses and more challengers could start to think?
Well, you know, I told you, you know, my background is a bit of, you know, I'm a computer engineer, so a bit of a technologist or techie. And our go-to is not to think in politics. So it took a while for us to realize that we were in a political campaign and the candidate was Uber. But that's really what it is that, you know, there's influence on politicians, city officials, and other folks that influence them. And so we've sort of learned over time that we have to engage in some way so that our side of the story I just told that brings so much good, I think, to a city, makes it work more efficiently and makes quality of life in a city so much better. We have to get that story out there. And I think, you know, a political campaign in many ways for us is getting better at communicating those benefits and the upside for the people in cities.
Well, very best of luck with your quest to rid certainly London's streets of cars. Ladies and gentlemen, Travis Kalanick.